lies my heart's speech. Your mercy is what I beseech. Keep in my heart your remembrance, and in your deen allow me to advance. Help me in my quest. Permit me to pass the ultimate test. Help me in my quest. Permit me to pass the ultimate test. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله وكفى وسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى، لا سيما المصطفى صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. My dear brothers and sisters, welcome to another live edition of your program Ask Huda. Our phone numbers beginning with area code are 002-0238-555-131 or 132, and the email address is ask@huda.tv, and the Facebook page is Dr. Muhammad Salah official. A few pending questions before we begin. Shiraz from the United Kingdom said, shall I wait to go to the plane to wear ihram, or can I just wear it at home once I take or perform ghusl? Whether you wear it at home or in the plane, that does not put you immediately in a state of ihram. The ihram outfit is just the outer part. One of the conditions of ihram is not to wear any stitched clothes. But what determines whether you have commenced into the act of ihram or not is your intention, which will be accompanied with the talbiyah whenever you say labbaik allahumma umratan. And when one should pronounce at talbiyah and declare that he's in ihram, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned the mawaqit. He appointed certain places, the Hulayfa, the Ta'arq, etc. And he said, هِيَ لَهُنَّ وَلِمَنْ مَرَّ عَلَيْهِنْ. These mawaqit, or five stations, the points that if anyone is from there or happen to pass through them, he should not enter Mecca or Al-Madinah without and cross any of these points without declaring the intention of ihram if they were going to perform umrah or hajj. So whenever the pilot, if you're flying any of these airlines where the pilot is aware of the concept of umrah or hajj, they normally would say that in half hour we will be in line with the miqat. Then a few minutes before we'll say that get ready, inshallah we'll be passing by the miqat. In this case, you should announce the talbiyah and say labbaik allahumma umratan. Is it permissible to say the talbiyah before the miqat? It is permissible. And you're not blameworthy. You don't have to pay any ransom. And you actually become in a condition of ihram. But it is not permissible to postpone the ihram until you pass the miqat, even a few yards or a few minutes. In this case, you have violated one of the wajibat, a mandatory act of umrah or hajj, which is assuming the intention of ihram from the miqat. Why am I saying that? I'm saying that because in case that you're afraid, or if you fly in an airline where the captain is unaware of that, normally they do not announce. In this case, you can put your ihram on, for instance, at the airport, and then whenever you board the plane, an hour or two before approaching Jeddah airport, he can declare the intention of ihram to be in the safe side. If you're in Medina currently, then obviously you put the ihram on at your hotel. Then when you go to the airport, that's normal. Everybody is in ihram, or a lot of people are in ihram. Nobody looks strange. Then once you board the plane, once the plane takes off, couple minutes after the flight takes off, the captain would say, we are now in line with the miqat. So it is not like 15 minutes or half hour, no. Because the whole flight is basically about 45 minutes or 40 minutes. If you're going by land, then you stop by the place where there is a masjid, which is known today as Abyar Ali. You don't have to enter the masjid. You don't have to get off the bus. You don't have to disembark from your car. While passing by at the miqat, you say labbaik allahumma umrah. May Allah accept and include us in your dua while performing umrah. Shiraz from the UK. His second question is, Is there any specific dua while visiting the grave of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? The etiquette of visiting the grave of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, is to invoke Allah to send the peace and the blessings upon him, not to make any dua for yourself or for others. Because the Prophet, peace be upon him, said, إِذَا سَأَلْتَ فَاسْأَلِ اللَّهِ وَإِذَا اسْتَعَنْتَ فَاسْتَعِنْ بِاللَّهِ Whenever you ask, you should only ask from Allah. Whenever you seek help, you should only seek the help of Allah, the Almighty. So whenever you come in line with the grave of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, normally it will be to your left-hand side. You look at it and you say, السلام عليك أيها النبي ورحمة الله وبركاته. This is how you send the salam upon the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You may say, I bear witness that you have delivered the message. أشهد أنك بلغت الرسالة وأديت الأمانة. Oh Allah, send your peace and blessings and salutation upon your Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. اللهم صل على عبدك ونبيك محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. Then you step forward, one step, where you'll find a little green sign which says, هنا يرقد أبو بكر الصديق. This is where Abu Bakr, may Allah be pleased with him, is lying down next to the Prophet. You say, السلام عليك يا خليفة رسول الله. This is how you greet him. And you say, رضي الله عنك. May Allah be pleased with you. Similarly with Amir al-Mu'mineen, Umar ibn Khattab. So you pray for them. You do not ask of them anything. After you finish your ziyarah, if you want to turn around, face the Qibla that is 90 degrees and make dua, it's entirely up to you. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Sister Fatima from the KSA, welcome to Ask Huda. Sister Fatima.
Yes, I have a couple of questions I'd like to ask you.
Go ahead, Sister Fatima, please.
Number one, I would like to know how to recite Rukya.
Okay.
Yeah, and number two, it is about the blessing that people are blessed. There are those who have more and there are those who have less. But most people consider those who have more to be like good people and those who have less like to be bad people. But the way I know is that nobody gets the blessing by his will, but by the will of God, because it is him who gives everything by his grace. So I would like you to explain that to me. It's what I don't understand. It is confusing.
Okay.
And another thing is about a mother. Hello?
Go ahead, Sister Fatima, I hear you.
Yeah. A mother who tried to block her daughter's marriage by using seer.
By using?
Witchcraft.
I miss the Sister Fatima, pardon me. By using what?
Seer.
Sihr. Okay, magic.
Yeah, that's magic.
Oh.
Because she wants to benefit from her financially.
Okay, I got your question.
Yeah. Then I would like to also ask about somebody who has lost interest in life. How can we help that person in Islam?
Okay.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you, Sister Fatima. Barakallahu fiki. Umm Suhaib from the KSA had a question last episode. The question was, what is the significance of reciting Surat Ad-Dukhan on Thursday night, which is basically, she means Friday night, which is the evening of Thursday. She's asking this because I'm pretty sure that you have heard before some ahadith, one which is narrated by Abu Huraira, may Allah be pleased with him, in which he says that من قرأ حميم الدخان في ليلة الجمعة غفر له. This is one narration. There is another couple of narrations with regards to the verses of Surat Ad-Dukhan, and it's the citation on the night of Friday, which precedes the morning. And all these ahadith are extremely weak, and there is no specific verses for the recitation of Surat Ad-Dukhan on Friday night whatsoever, because we rely on sound ahadith when it comes to the verses of anything, whether chapters of the Quran or otherwise. There is another narration in which أبو أمامة narrated that من قرأ حميم الدخان في ليلة الجمعة أو يوم الجمعة بنى الله له بيتا في الجنة. And that's a very 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 weak hadith. It says that whoever recites Surah Ad-Dukhan on Friday night or during the day on Friday, Allah will build him a house in paradise. We cannot confirm that because basically the hadith is extremely weak. Barakallahu feekum. Umar from Turkey deposited the question about mentioning the name of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, in the prayer. Then is it allowed for one who is already in the prayer to send the peace and the blessings upon him? For instance, if the Imam is reciting Muhammadur Rasulullah والذين معه أشداء على الكفار رحماء بينهم. The ayah which we explained before, the name of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is mentioned. Do you send the peace and the blessings upon him in the prayer? If the Imam is reciting, you should be quiet. You do not make any invocation. Some people, whenever the Imam is reciting and says, إِيَّكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّكَ نَسْتَعِينَ, they say, إِسْتَعَنْتُ بِكَ يَا رَبُّ, oh Allah, I seek your help. This is invalid. Because the ayah is very clear. وَإِذَا قُرِئَ الْقُرْآنُ فَاسْتَمِعُوا لَهُ وَأَنصِتُوا لَعَلَّكُمْ تُرْحَمُونَ. There is almost a general consensus amongst the scholars that this ayah is revealed concerning the recitation of the Quran within the prayer. If the Imam is reciting, the followers should be quiet. They make no invocations. They do not send any peace or salutation upon the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But in your ruku', in your sujood, you want to send the peace and the blessings upon the Prophet, no problem. Okay? Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Brother Muhammad from Nigeria.
Assalamu alaikum. Good evening, Sheikh.
Good evening to you. Alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
I hope you are really doing great.
Wonderful. Alhamdulillah. Thank you for asking.
MashaAllah. Actually, my question goes this way. I've had many imams send the tafsir of an ayah in the Quran that says, in Surah Al-Isra, وَلَا تَقَتُلُوا أَوْلَادَكُمْ خَشْيَةَ إِمْلَاقٍ نَحْنُ نَرْزُقُهُمْ وَإِيَّاكُمْ. So my question is that at that time, they were like killing their children because they are afraid of poverty. But this time around, actually, people are not really killing the children, but they will not just burn the children, but it is actually the same purpose that they are afraid of that poverty. So actually, I'm really confused. When someone like prevent himself from having a child, being afraid of poverty, can you equally link it to killing the child or something like that? That's my question. Thank you. Jazakallah khair.
Thank you, brother Muhammad from Nigeria. Barakallah feek. Okay. Sure, I will be happy to answer your question, inshallah, Azza wa Jal. Jaka Hydra has a question, which is, what is the ruling on wearing niqab, then removing it afterward? Well, it depends. First of all, we hold a stand that there is a difference of opinion with regards to the mandate of wearing a face veil for women. And we normally mention the khilaf, the difference of opinion. We do not present a single view and we say this is what every woman must follow, what every man must follow. We mention that there is a difference of opinion. By the end, if I recommend something based on my education, my conviction, my study, this is what I believe, what I think. But you're not obliged to follow my view or my opinion, especially if you consider the other view or if you follow another scholar and he says that the other view is more sound. So whether the niqab or face veil is mandatory or not, there is a difference of opinion. Now, if a woman adopted the view that it is mandatory and she is fully convinced of the proofs, the evidences that she must cover her face, and she did, then it has become mandatory for her to do so. Can she take it off afterward? What is the reason? Have you changed your mind? Have you changed your view? If you're convinced that it is a must and you take it off, you're liable, you're responsible, because that's something you treated as mandatory. But as we understand that there are some circumstances where Muslim women are being persecuted in many parts of the world. They prevent women from going in public wearing niqab. So if she does take it off, she's not blameworthy because it was not her choice. She didn't willingly choose. Similarly, the matter of wearing hijab. But if you change your mind without any reason, without any conviction, of course you're blameworthy. May Allah guide us to what is best. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Sister Fatima from Nigeria, assalamu alaikum.
Yeah, wa alaikum assalam. Yeah, I have a question, Sheikh, about this hair extension.
Mm-hmm. Go ahead, Sister Fatima.
Yes, is it allowed for a Muslim sister to use hair extensions because they are synthetic, not human hair?
It is not permissible to wear whether synthetic or genuine hair of somebody else. It is not permissible to wear a wig as well. And as a matter of fact, there is a serious hadith warning against that, okay? When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam forbade that and he said, لَعَنَ اللَّهُ الْوَاصِلَةَ وَالْمُسْتَوْصِلَةَ, he did not specify whether it is the hair of another woman or a tail of a horse, okay? Thank you, Sister Fatima. Brother Muhammad, assalamu alaikum.
Assalamu alaikum.
Alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
How are you doing, Shay?
I'm fine, alhamdulillah. Thank you for asking.
I have two questions to ask you.
Mm-hmm.
The first one I would like to ask, is it possible to close our eyes while we are praying?
Okay.
And the second question, is it possible for women, while we are making wudu, is it possible to get the water on our head, I mean all of it or part of it?
Okay.
That's it. Thank you so much.
Thank you. You're welcome. Barakallahu feek, Muhammad from Egypt. Sister Fatima from the KSA asked about, first of all, how to give ruqya. How to give ruqya, you can either recite ruqya for yourself or for others. We awfully discussed how the Prophet, peace be upon him, used to recite before going to sleep Al-Mu'awwidhat, the last three chapters of the Quran, Al-Ikhlas, Al-Falaq, and Al-Nas. And he would recite the set of the three chapters thrice. And after each recitation, he would blow in his palms and wipe over his face, over his head, and as much as he can cover of his body. That is also one means of ruqya. The recitation of Ayatul Kursi, the recitation of Surah Al-Fatiha, the recitation of any part of the Quran with the intention of using this as means of ruqya. Allah the Almighty said in the Quran, وَنُنَزِّلُ مِنَ الْقُرْآنِ مَا هُوَ شِفَاءٌ وَرَحْمَةٌ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ وَلَا زِيدُ الظَّالِمِينَ إِلَّا خَسَارًا. So the entire Quran is a cure. Umar ibn al-Khattab, may Allah be pleased with him, used to recite ruqya via the means of only Surah Al-Fatiha. Only Surah Al-Fatiha, and it was most effective. If you recite the ruqya upon a body part which is aching or ailing, that you place your palm upon it and you recite whatever you want of the Quran, Ayatul Kursi, Al-Mu'awwidhat, Al-Fatiha, and you recite some supplications. Allahumma inni a'udhu bika min sharri ma ajidu wa uhadir. Oh Allah, I seek refuge with you against what I find of pain, of fear, of whatever, and what I'm afraid of. Min sharri ma ajidu wa uhadir. Three times. أسأل الله العظيم رب العرش العظيم أن يشفيك. If you recite a ruqya upon somebody who is sick, if this person is of the same gender, if he is related to you, a mahram, you can place your palm upon the forehead or the body part which is experiencing the pain, and you recite, أعيذك بكلمات الله التامة من كل شيطان وهامة ومن كل عين لامة ومن شر النفاثات في العقد ومن شر حاسد إذا حسد. There are many supplications. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, whenever you visit a sick person and you recite, أسأل الله العظيم رب العرش العظيم أن يشفيك. Very simple. I ask Allah the Great, the Lord of the Great Throne to cure you 7 times. If this person was not due to die in this sickness, he would recover by the will of Allah. Okay? Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Sister Safiya from United Arab Emirates.
Hello?
Yes, assalamu alaikum, Sister Safiya.
Wa alaikum assalam, Sheikh. How are you?
Fine, alhamdulillah. Thank you for asking.
Sir, I have one question.
Mm-hmm.
A friend of mine has introduced a man and a woman. They both are divorced. And she thought that probably they might make a proper couple and they might get married. Her intention was good. But unfortunately, both of them, they met, they became friends, they started dating, and they have just gone ahead with everything. Now my friend is so worried that she probably is being a part of the sin if they are committing any sin, and she is feeling very depressed. So I just thought maybe I could ask your opinion in matter of this.
Sister Safiya, in the sound hadith, our most beloved Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, said, إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَاتِ Deeds are but by their intentions. If your friend's intention was sincere to introduce them so that they can get married legitimately and have a legitimate relationship, she's not blameworthy. But I guess she would have a say, she would still have an access to forbid them again is dating and again is going out together without having a legitimate relationship, even up to the point of threatening to boycott them and sever her relations with them. But is she blameworthy? No, she is not blameworthy. If she was sincere from the beginning, she only introduced them in order to get married and establish a lawful relationship. Thank you, Sister Safiya. Sister Fatima's second question about al-barakah and how to obtain it in one's wealth, in one's children. Al-barakah is a divine blessing that makes a little thing abundant, that makes a weak person powerful, that makes little means great means, that makes a small income sufficient for a big family, and they do not ever sense or feel that they are in need. That's called al-barakah. Whenever somebody doesn't pray Fajr on time, فَلَيْسَ فِي يَوْمِهِ بَرَكَةٌ He goes to work, he works hard, he tries to earn, but there is no blessing. Even if he were to make an income or money on that day, it can be wasted in one of those means. The child gets sick, the wife is having an accident, his car got dented or in a collision or whatever. So al-barakah is to be sought only from the provider of the blessings, that is only Allah the Almighty. Whenever you give any charity to help somebody else, Allah the Almighty says in the sound hadith, يا ابن آدم أنفق عليك spend of your wealth in a charity, I shall spend upon you. And imagine Allah spending and provision to you and upon you. There is no comparison between your spending and His. So that's barakah. A person who begins his day after praying by the recitation of the adhkar, his day is full of barakah. A person whom upon leaving his house recites the adhkar. Adhkar means plural of dhikr, which is celebrating the praise of Allah, remembering Allah the Almighty. Imagine in the hadith that Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, said, if one upon leaving his house says, Bismillah, tawakkaltu ala Allah, la hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. In the name of Allah, I put my trust in Allah. There is no mighty nor power but with Allah. Then you say, Allahumma inni a'udhu bika an adilla aw udall aw azilla aw uzall aw azlima aw uzlam aw ajhala aw ujhal alay. You know what happens? Satans who are awaiting you outside in order to mislead you, in order to topple you, in order to put you in trouble. One of them would say to another, what can we do with somebody who is protected, guarded, and insured? Because a caller will address this person whenever he says, Bismillah, tawakkaltu ala Allah, la hawla wa la quwwata illa billah, it will be said to him, hudita, wa kufita, wa wuqit. So Satans will distance themselves from him. They say, this man is wearing an armor. This man is protected. That's called baraka. Whenever you miss an accident and you see somebody else who is driving ahead of you, then he cut you short and he drove in front of you. Then he came in a car collision instead of you. That's a barakah that Allah blessed you. He protected you. Perhaps you've recited your adhkar in the morning. You ask Allah to protect you. Bismillah alladhi la yadurru ma'asmihi shay'un fil ardi wa la fil samai wa huwa sami'u al-alim. Al-baraka in food, whenever before eating you say Bismillah, there is baraka in it. Al-baraka is in the center of the plate. Whenever you guys follow the sunnah and eat from the in front of you, from the sides, and leave the center to the end, there is baraka in your food. Whenever you thank Allah upon eating, you benefit from the food, even if it is little, even if it doesn't have meat, even if it is not that nutritive, because there is baraka in it. Whenever you go to sleep, a lot of people cannot sleep without taking sleep pills. Cannot sleep until taking sometimes drugs to be knocked down. While others, when they lie down on their bed and they gather their palms, they recite their adhkar, they recite al-mu'awwidhat, then they sleep on the right side and say bismika Allahumma amutu ahya. Before finishing the adhkar, they are already in another world. Barakah. Sometimes the person lies down for a couple hours. Then he gets up an hour before Fajr to pray his night prayer. Then pray Fajr, then recite adhkar, and he feels fresh. And he goes to work and he's very active. While another person who spent, 8 hours, 9 hours, 10 hours in bed, and he got up, he missed Fajr prayer. He prayed Fajr or Fajr after sunrise. So he feels like his bones are broken. He is fatigued even though he just got out of his bed. Why? Because there is no barakah. So it is not about the quantity, rather it is about the quality. And what makes any quantity, even if it is little, with a high quality, al-barakah. That's a secret that Allah the Almighty deposits in something that which He likes in order to increase the provision of a person, to increase his lifespan, to increase. Increasing the lifespan does not necessarily mean that if he was due to live for 60, he will make him live for 80. No, it could be through the barakah. The hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, مَنْ أَحَبَّ أَنْ يُبْسَطَ لَهُ فِي رِزْقِهِ وَأَنْ يُنْسَأَ لَهُ فِي أَثَرِهِ فَلْيَصِلُوا رَحِمَهُ. One of the great means of barakah in your wealth and in your life, in your lifespan, is upholding the ties of kinship. Is that you feel your life valuable. In one day you achieve a lot of tasks, barakah. While somebody else or the same person who did not fulfill his duty to Allah or his iman was weak, did not recite his adhkar, he struggled to get one paper signed a day or two or three and he cannot get it signed by an officer or by a manager. Why? There is no barakah. He's in trouble. After visiting many of my family members one day and the road was really tough, I returned and my son, who was in the stroller, subhanAllah, he fell off the stairs, long stairs. And I was in the shower place when I heard that. I was certain that I'm going to lose him. And subhanAllah, I rushed out of the shower place and I tried to check on him. He was totally untouched by the grace of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So I refer that, I said that is definitely because of the barakah of upholding the ties of kinship. Brothers and sisters, let's take a short break and we'll be back inshallah in a couple of minutes. Please stay tuned. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh and welcome back. Sister Samira from the KSA, you remember she called and she asked about a hadith that if you recite Subhanallah al-Azim wa bihamdih three times after Fajr, this person will not be afflicted with four diseases including leprosy, blindness and insanity. I investigated and the hadith is narrated by Qubaysah Ibn al-Mukhariq, may Allah be pleased with him. It's a weak hadith, okay? The hadith is collected by Imam Ahmad in his Musnad, but it's a weak hadith. Barakallahu feekum. we answer the question about the barakah, and now we have Fatma's next question about somebody, a woman who is utilizing magic or sorcery in order to get her daughter married. Going to magicians or asking them for assistance is an act of disbelief, an act of kufr. وَمَا يُعَلِّمَانِ بِهِ مِنْ أَحَدٍ حَتَّى يَقُولَ إِنَّمَا نَحْنُ فِتْنَةٌ فَلَا تَكْفُرْ. So the question that it is not permissible to seek the help of any sorcerer, even for good causes, to get somebody married, to make somebody love another person. Unfortunately, in some societies, some women, some women, in order to maintain their husband's love, they may go to a sorcerer, to a soothsayer, to a magician, to do a talisman or ta'weed. You see the ayah of Surah Al-Baqarah, وَمَا يُعَلِّمَانِ مِنْ أَحَدٍ حَتَّى يَقُولَ إِنَّمَا نَحْنُ فِتْنَةٌ فَلَا تَكْفُرْ فَيَتَعَلَّمُونَ مِنْهُمَا مَا يُفَرِّقُونَ بِهِ بَيْنَ الْمَرْءِ وَزَوْجَهِ. Among the acts of sorcery, it can actually separate between a loving couple. And it can make a person fall in love with a woman whom he does not even know. So if a woman utilizes sorcery in order to make somebody get married or somebody love this woman or whatever, this act is equivalent to disbelief and it is not permissible whatsoever. Brother Muhammad, who called from Egypt, asked about two things. He asked about closing the eyes in the prayer and whether it's permissible or not. One is supposed to look while in the prayer to the spot of sujood, to mawdi' sujood, whether while in the standing position or in ruku' or while in between the two sajdas. But if the person cannot obtain khushu' unless if he closes his eyes, it becomes permissible. So al-asl, originally, it is disliked because you're supposed to practice the sunnah of looking at the spot where you put your forehead in prostration. But if you fail to concentrate or to maintain khushu' unless if you close your eyes, then in this case, whichever way is better with regards to obtaining khushu', it makes it permissible. A woman and wiping over the hair in wudu. Is it sufficient to wipe on some parts of the hair or does it have to be the entire head? There is a general consensus amongst all the scholars of the Ummah that in the wudu, wiping over the head is a pillar. Why? Because Allah the Almighty said in Surah Al-Ma'idah, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا إِذَا قُمْتُمْ إِلَى الصَّلَاةِ فَاغْسِلُوا وُجُوهَكُمْ وَأَيْدِيَكُمْ إِلَى الْمَرَافِقِ وَامْسَحُوا بِرُؤُوسِكُمْ وَأَرْجُلَكُمْ إِلَى الْكَعْبَيْنِ. So wiping over the heads is a pillar, okay, in wudu. Now, the scholars differed, though, with regards to the meaning of بِرُؤُوسِكُمْ. Does it mean that the entire head? Or it would be sufficient to cover al-ba' here, to feed al-tab'id, some of the head. And in this case, one quarter would be sufficient. So we have the Maliki school of thought, and the Hanbali, Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, and Imam Malik ibn Anas, are of the view that it is a must to wipe over the entire head in the wudu. While Imam Abu Hanifa, may Allah have mercy on him, and Imam Muhammad ibn Idris al-Shafi'i are of the view that بعض الرأس, some of the head or the hair is sufficient. And they all relied on their views. They relied on the same ayah of Surah Al-Ma'idah, number 6. امسحوا برؤوسكم, and they said, الباء تفيد التبعيض. So it doesn't have to be the entire head. So there is a difference of opinion. The more right view, of course, is to wipe over the head one time, then come back with it, with your wet hands. But if women in public places and they do not have access to do that, then wiping over some of the hair or the head would be sufficient. Inshallah, they can also, if they fail to take off their hijab, like in public, they can wipe over their khimar. Okay? Muhammad from Nigeria asked about the ayah of Surah Al-Isra, وَلَا تَقْتُلُوا أَوْلَادَكُمْ خَشْيَةَ إِمْلَاقٍ نَحْنُ نَرْزُقُهُمْ وَإِيَّاكُمْ. And as you understand that there is another reference in Surah Al-An'am, وَلَا تَقْتُلُوا أَوْلَادَكُمْ مِنْ إِمْلَاقٍ نَحْنُ نَرْزُقُكُمْ وَإِيَّاهُمْ. So in one ayah, both ayahs forbid a very evil tradition that the Arab used to practice before Islam, which is al-wa'd, mainly wa'd al-banat. وَإِذَا الْمَوْءُودَةُ سُئِلَتْ بِأَيِّ ذَنْبٍ قُتِلَتْ, burying their daughters alive. Because the person who would work and earn his living and living for the entire family and carry arms during the war and the attacks would be the man, not the woman. A woman would be like a liability. This is what they used to think. So Islam came to nullify all of that and establish the fact that من عمل صالحا من ذكر أو أنثى وهو مؤمن فلنحيينه حياة طيبة. Whether a male or a female, both will be treated the same. When it comes to doing good deeds, they will be rewarded the same. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I'll get back to the question inshallah. Brother Ashfaq from United Arab Emirates. Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. How are you, Sheikh?
Ahlan wa sahlan, Brother Ashfaq. Welcome to the program.
Sheikh, I have two questions.
Mm-hmm.
My first question is regarding this Salatul Duha and Salatul Shuruq.
Mm-hmm.
If I pray Salatul Shuruq, do I have to pray Salatul Duha, Sheikh?
Al-Duha and Al-Shuruq are the same.
Yes.
In the Sunnah, it is called Duha. Its time is after Shuruq. That's why you guys in Urdu, in the Indo-Pak society, you call it Shuruq. But it is called in the Sunnah, the Hadith of Abu Hurairah, may Allah be pleased with him, when he said, أوصاني خليلي بثلاث, my best companion advised me to adhere to three practices. One of whom is ركعتي الضحى. The word الضحى means also the forenoon, which is a few minutes after sunrise. 15 minutes after sunrise, you can start praying duha until 10 minutes, 15 minutes before dhuhr time. Its rak'ahs are two, at least up to eight rak'ahs, two by two. You can pray them all, you know, at the same time. And you can pray them at the earliest time or the later time. You can pray two rak'ahs right after 15 minutes after sunrise. And you can pray the remaining afterward. But there is a great virtue in attending Salatul Duha, which is the same that you guys call it Shuruq or Ishraq. Ashfaq, are you still there?
Yeah.
Okay,
my second question, is it necessary for a woman to cover her hair in front of her mahrams in the house?
Okay.
And if somebody is covering due out of modesty, will she be rewarded for that?
Okay. A woman doesn't have to cover her hair, nor arms, nor legs before a mahram. And the mahram, as we discussed many, many times, you go back to many references, one in Surah An-Nur, one in Surah An-Nisa, number 23, in which Allah the Almighty says, حُرِّمَتْ عَلَيْكُمْ أُمَّهَاتُكُمْ. So one's mother is a mahram. He is a mahram to his mother. He is a mahram to his daughter. He is a mahram to his sister. He is a mahram to his aunt, paternal or maternal. Okay? So can my mother sit without wearing a scarf in front of me? Absolutely. What if she wears a scarf before me? Is there an extra reward in that? We do not expect nor believe that there is an extra reward out of modesty because she is already modest. Whenever she is not wearing a scarf before her son, before her brother, before her her father. Sometimes, whenever we live in societies where the society is corrupt, whenever a family member is, addicting to any of these, you know, illicit relations and activities, watching porn materials, so this person is a source of fitna. So the sister wears a hijab before her brother because of that, out of fear of fitna. or the woman is wearing a scarf before her father-in-law because she is afraid of the fitna. There are some circumstantial evidences that this guy is not really religiously committed and she fears falling in the fitna. In this case, yes. But in regular circumstances, in regular conditions, a woman doesn't have to wear a hijab or a scarf before or cover her hair before any of her maharim. Barakallahu fiqh ashfaq. The ayah of Surah Al-Isra and it's similar to Surah Al-An'am. It's very beautiful that after Allah the Almighty forbade burying the newborn, the babies, the girls alive, and he eliminated totally the evil habit of wa'dul banat, then Allah the Almighty addressed those who believed by saying that وَلَا تَقْتُلُوا أَوْلَادَكُمْ خَشْيَةَ إِمْلَاقٍ خَشْيَةَ إِمْلَاقٍ نَحْنُ نَرْزُقُهُمْ وَإِيَّاكُمْ is of Surah Al-Isra. إِنَّ قَتْلَهُمْ كَانَ خِطْأً كَبِيرًا. It came amongst many other adab etiquettes such as do not commit zina, do not go near zina, do not kill your own selves, do not kill others, do not oppress others, do not touch the wealth of an orphan except with the just means, etc. In Surah Al-An'am likewise, but the difference is in Surah Al-An'am, Allah the Almighty said, نَحْنُ نَرْزُقُكُمْ وَإِيَّهُمْ. So in Surah Al-Isra, نَحْنُ نَرْزُقُهُمْ وَإِيَّاكُمْ. يعني, if you do kill them, get rid of them because of fear of poverty, don't worry about it. Your provision is maintained and guaranteed and it is untouched. Your son is not going to share with you your provision. Your provision is destined for you once you are in the womb of your mother. So when you have a child, two or three or four, they're not going to make you hungry because they're not going to take from your provision. They come with their own. نَحْنُ نَرْزُقُهُمْ وَإِيَّاكُمْ in Al-Isra. While here in Al-An'am, نَحْنُ نَرْزُقُكُمْ وَإِيَّاهُمْ. Yeah, we provide for you and we provide for them. You have your own provision, which is untouched. And they have their own provision, which is untouched. Imagine when the child, when the embryo in the womb of the mother, who feeds the embryo? How is the embryo being fed? You know? Who feeds them? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And once the child is born through breastfeeding, and once the child, goes through the weaning, then he starts gradually eating. That is his provision. Your risk will be increased in proportion with the need of your child or children. This is guaranteed, as Allah the Almighty said, for those who truly believe in Him. That's why it is mentioned twice. It is not permissible to undergo or to go for abortion under any circumstances except in one condition. Whenever there is a life threat to the mother, to the pregnant woman. But when a couple says, when the couple say that we have already three kids and now she is pregnant and we don't know how we're going to provide for them and the schooling and the formula and the diapers and all of that, we rather go for abortion, that is killing. That is killing. Similar to killing a human being, living human being, even though the embryo is still in the womb of the mother. But if there is a life threat, the woman was not supposed to conceive because of health matters, health risk. In this case, if they go for abortion, they are not blameworthy. What about those who decide not to have children out of fear of poverty? They don't trust Allah. They don't trust Allah. They don't have tawakkul. But is it permissible to do family planning? It is permissible. Now you have a child. And Allah Almighty says in Surah Al-Baqarah, وَالْوَالِدَاتُ يُرْضِعْنَ أَوْلَادَهُنَّ حَوْلَيْنِ كَامِلَيْنِ لِمَنْ أَرَادَ أَنْ يُتِمَّ الرَّضَاعَ. So you allow a couple years before the next conception so that the child will be breastfed properly, will stand on foot, and the mother will be capable to take care of one child at a time. That is permissible. But to say, I don't want any kids, I'm afraid that if I have children, this is a mentality of those who do not believe in God. And I have heard that a lot in the West, in the US, in Europe, because sometimes even a girl said that she doesn't want to have babies because she's afraid that she's going to mess up her belly. She wants to have flat belly. She doesn't want, she exercises every day. She's afraid that if she gets pregnant, and that will affect her figure. So life for those people is very selfish. But for us who understand that when we get married and when we satisfy our desire in lawful means and when we have children, this is our investment in this life. Those kids, inshallah, when we bring them up properly, then we depart this life, they will continue to pray for us. This is our asset. This is the act which will benefit us after death. أَوَلَدٍ صَالِحٍ يَدْعُ لَهُ. May Allah bless us all, brothers and sisters. I think, alhamdulillah, we did answer all the questions, including the pending questions. So we'll be very happy to wrap it up today in peace and ask Allah the Almighty to accept from all of us. Until next time, I leave you in Allah's care and protection. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Allah is my heart's speech. Your mercy is what I beseech.